letter WAMX. So they arrived at Oak Island today. They'll be delivered to Tremley Point the next day or so. Either last weekend or the weekend before, NJ Transit ran an all dual mode weekend. They're doing maintenance on the wires on the Morrison Essex. So all the traffic were dual mode locomotives. That's the first time. That's the first time since they've it's been all dual mode that I'm aware of. And as far as I know, everything went well. I haven't heard that anything didn't go well, but all the New York trains were coming out electric on Amtrak and then converting to diesel on the Morrison Essex. So it was an interesting operating weekend. Trying to think what else in the news department. There was a lot of flood. NJ Transit, I haven't heard of the outcome, but they had a few trains stranded out in Boundbrook with the high water. Boundbrook always floods, but this time it flooded more than usual. And then there's lots of videos on YouTube and Facebook about the trains plowing through the water during the heavy storm. So if anybody caught some of those, some are pretty dramatic. Yeah, Tom, have you got any news from your end of the world? We'd certainly love to hear it.
Not a lot. Kind of survived the storm as well. I mean, we actually had a tornado here in our end of the state last night, early this morning. A minor one didn't do much damage. It was mostly in the woods.
Yeah, but that's unusual up there.
Yeah, very, very.
Well, if we get outside our area a little bit, out on the Cumberland Toltec, they had four pre-1900 locomotives operating last week. And that was fun to see. Two of them were wood burners. And they were celebrating the 50th anniversary of the Cumberland Toltec. So a lot of rail fans were out there. The big boy has finished its tour of Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas. And it's back in Cheyenne. They just put it away. So that'll probably be it for the year for that. We'll see what the Union Pacific does next year with it. And hopefully next year I can go out and see it myself. I haven't seen it run yet.
And all right. We're live on Facebook, Mike. So if you want to introduce Tom here, and Tom, we'll turn it over to you in just a second.
All right. Well, we'd like to thank Tom for putting on a show for us tonight. Tom is a very creative photographer and one of the deans of New England rail photography of this generation. So we're very happy to see his work on this type of presentation. So I'd like to turn over to Tom Nanos.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Mike. Thank you. Thank you, Richie. Thank you, everyone at Tri-State. happy to put this on for you guys. So let's get rolling here. Share my screen. All right. And that one's not part of the presentation. All right. So here we go. So what kind of the premise behind the whole presentation is going to be the story behind the photos. A lot of the photos I picked out, I think I picked out 65 altogether. And we'll just kind of go into a little detail of either how it was made or the circumstances around it or how it led to different photos that I've taken over the years. So for the first one here, we're going back to, this would be September 1st of 2002 in Palmer, Mass. This is the American Orient Express. This was a deadhead move that was coming down from Canada. It came down the New England Central, went all the way to New London, and then would go over to Providence, Rhode Island, where they would board the passengers and then do a tour around New England in the fall foliage. And this was supposed to come through Palmer at about dawn. So we got up early to head up to Palmer to catch it there. Unfortunately, it got delayed at the border because somebody in Canada couldn't get a bridge tender in time. So it sat there for a few hours and it appeared late, way behind schedule. But the kind of catch here was, is I had my wife with me. She was riding shotgun with me and she was 6 months pregnant, 7 months pregnant. She was a trooper. We made it through. We ended up chasing and photographing the train from Palmer down to New London. We didn't follow it. We didn't continue on it when it went on Amtrak to Providence. I kind of figured I was pushing my limit already, and we just broke off there. And yes, we are still married. Okay, moving next into Essex. This one particular shot, this was taken in August of 2003. Took this, it just kind of struck me, the composition struck me. Bill Drotar is the engineer there, and that's Ken Blandina walking up into the cab there. He was the fireman that day. At that time, I knew nobody at Essex. I was completely new, really new, fairly new to the railroad photography realm. I started in late 2001, early 2002, around there. So at this point, I was just kind of shooting what struck my eye and all of that. And I posted this on the Any Rail, the photo archive. A few days later, Bill in the cab there contacted me. He says, would it be possible to get a print of this? I said, yeah, absolutely. I said, if you get me a cab ride. He says, yeah, no problem. So we ended up, we met up and he got me a cab ride, and I got the ride in 97. Took a nice ride, and he also introduced me to the people at the Valley. And this photo is what really started my relationship with the Valley. Over the past, 17 years now, I've developed a very good relationship with the folks there in management throughout all of the crafts. It's a great place to do work with. I mean, we take care of each other. It's fun, and it's great. And you'll see a lot of Valley stuff in the presentation tonight. I do tend to frequent there. But again, this one photograph kind of opened the door for me. And another open door. So this was the FL9 trip after the two FL9s were painted into this, I guess, CNO-esque scheme. This was one of my trips with a good friend of mine, Bob LeMay, who I'm sure most of you know. Bob and I kind of would take trips every now and then. I think this was my second trip with Bob. So we went out to Port Jervis. The weather was awful. It was terrible. It was raining. But we still went. We shot. It was history. We figured we'd document it. And the other significant thing about this trip, not only did I come away with some pretty good shots on ISO 400 slide film, but I also got to meet Steve Barry, the editor of Rail Fan and Railroad. And that developed into friendship. Steve and I would go out and shoot every now and then after this. And it also led to not only and opening the door there into Rail Fan and Railroad. I've had a number of articles published, some photos and this, that, and the other within the magazine. And kind of tying into that, another Bob trip was actually yesterday. Bob has, what was it, 2 years ago, I think Bob moved to Florida. So we haven't been able to get together and shoot, take one of our trips. So I saw that he was up here in Connecticut for a couple of weeks, and we figured out a time that the two of us could get together. And we took one of our trips, and we went up to Springfield. We spent the day up at Springfield Station, and then we ended the day here at the old Basketball Hall of Fame, with a nice view of a CT Rail commuter train heading out of Springfield, heading down to Hartford, and eventually into New Haven. Kind of flashing back a little bit here. So this one was in December of 2005, late December, December 28th. I was riding along with the Connecticut Southern crew that day, taking photos. Actually, I was taking photos for Railroad Illustrated Stay in North America. This shot ended up in the magazine. What had happened was the job was switching around Hartford Yard. So we were pulling into Murphy Road Recycling to switch out cars, pull the loads out of there, and drop some empties in. So tying on to the loads there, it was kind of a hard hit. When we hit, we started hearing this hissing. After a little investigation, it was found that an air pipe under the cab had dislodged, the fitting had dislodged. So, am I getting a little echo? No. Okay. So then, not having any tools on board, the crew, the engineer called the head maintenance guy for the Connecticut Southern and said that he was in, I think he was up in Vermont on the New England Central at the time, so he couldn't come down. So they kind of improvised. They went into Murphy Road Recycling, their customer, and got one of their mechanics out there who climbed up in, figured out exactly what they needed, took a ride down the road to Granger, got the parts, came back, he installed them, put the airline back together, and we ended up finishing the rest of the day. Just a little bit, something a little bit different, not just a typical ride along. And then continuing into the ride alongs, a friend of mine used to be an engineer for Shoreline East, which is a commuter, Connecticut State Department of Transportation run commuter line that runs between New Haven and New London, Connecticut, along the shoreline. One morning I rode along with him. This was a little after sunup. This was in 2006, March of 2006. So the run from, I would got on the train with him in New London, we rode to New Haven, and then the trip back to New London was a deadhead move, so there were no passengers on board. So he looks at me on the way back, he says, any place you want me to slow down or stop or something for a picture? So I said, all right, the tunnels in New Haven, so just go slow through there. So I said, all right, no problem. So as we come up to the tunnels in east of New Haven, I knew they were all nice and brick lined and had these the smoke chimneys in there when the light would be coming in and all of that. So I start setting up my tripod in the front window of the cab control car. And he says, I just throw the door open. It'll be a better view. So I'm like, oh, okay. So we're moving along. I throw the front door open, set the camera up, snap this shot of us going through the tunnel under East Haven, sorry. And now in Willimantic. So this is a shot of Providence Worcester train NR4 coming into Willimantic. At this time, and this was in January of 2008, a very cold evening. So this is the job that does the interchange between Providence and Worcester and the New England Central and Willimantic. So this particular evening, I'm sitting on my couch and I get a call on my phone. Who's this? And I look at who's calling. It's like, oh, I know who that is. It was the engineer on this job. And this was, just to kind of clarify, this was before the cell phone ban came into effect. So I answer the call and he says, we're coming to Willimantic. Where do you want me to stop the train? So I'm like, oh, okay. So I said, okay, you know, the curve right by the old treadmill and all of that. And he says, yeah, okay, no problem. He says, all right, I'll meet you there. So I get there and Bob LeMay was with me as well here. So I called him up and said, get your butt to Willimantic quick. We got something special coming in. We're going to be able to position the train. And so as they're coming into view down at the curve down here, they knew that where we were going to be set up. He calls me back again. He says, all right, tell me where to stop. So we pull him in. We said, right here. Okay, so stop him right here. He says, okay, just let me know when you're done and we'll head off. So we snap off a few shots. I got this nice night view here. You get the little waterfall over on the left behind the trees, then the old American threadmills. And then the other kind of interesting thing is, I think it was Hurricane Irene took this smokestack down and damaged it, and then they ended up demolishing it. So that's no longer there. That's a bit of history there. Okay, on another Connecticut Southern ride. This particular job was just working in Hartford Yard, didn't do much else, so it was kind of boring until a cut bar bent and they couldn't, then the pin wouldn't drop on the coupler. So here the engineer and the conductor are muscling it back into position, and then they ended up bending the cut bar back so it would operate correctly. Just got kind of a little overview of them muscling it back into place. So we get back on the train and we're just kind of going back and forth within the yard. It's kind of boring photographically, nothing special. So I kind of thinking, it's like, all right, I have my monopod with me. I have my cable release with me. So I took my camera, put it on the monopod, stood on the front of the locomotive and stuck the camera down at track level. And got this shot of the train going over the diamond. This is the old Hartford Diamond, the diamond within Hartford Yard. Again, just kind of boredom breeds creativity, or at least a different idea. Now we'll move down to Florida. So this is Florida East Coast. This is in Boca Raton, Florida. Not far from my parents' house. I think my mom's on. Hi, Ma. So this is kind of a nondescript shot. It's one of the EMD SD70M-2s that the FEC got that ended up here in New England. So fast forward a few years where this particular locomotive was in the Plainfield, in the Providence Worcester's Plainfield shop, getting converted and being repainted into Providence Worcester colors. So there's the 102 on the left, which would become 4302, and 4301, which was Florida East Coast 100, is completed, well, kind of completed. After this 4301 was painted, the owner of the railroad did not like the position of the white stripe down the side of the locomotive. They thought it was too high, so they ended up repainting it. But that's another story. That's another presentation. But then 102, after completion, there it is in the full PNW scheme. And this is on a ethanol train through Baltic, Connecticut, running from Willimantic to Plainfield. And then, of course, this is probably the shortest paint scheme, shortest lived paint scheme in history, because not long after this, Genesee and Wyoming bought out the Providence and Worcester and started to repaint the entire fleet. So in about a year after being painted into Providence Worcester colors, it got the G&W corporate colors, somewhat affectionately called candy corns. Take it or leave it, whatever. I mean, it is what it is. But these two locomotives are no longer on the PNW. They were reassigned first, I think, to the Buffalo and Pittsburgh, and then they're out, I think, in Oregon right now, somewhere out on the West Coast on another G&W line. Okay, so this one here, this is Providence Worcester train NR2 in Preston, Connecticut. In the background there is the Mohegan Sun Casino on the Mohegan Reservation. And this is the Thames River. So the kind of interesting thing, there was a few of us up at the foot of the bridge. So this is the Route 2A bridge, the Mohegan Pequot Bridge, which goes between Uncasville and Preston, Connecticut. So we were standing up there waiting for the train. And just as the train went by, a Connecticut State Trooper came up and he starts yelling at us. So we were off behind the guardrails, we were off the roadway. Well, I think one of the guys was up on the guardrail itself, just getting his angle, getting up above the tree or whatever. And the trooper is yelling at us, "Get the expletive off my bridge." And he's obviously a little agitated and he didn't know what we were doing apparently. And so we said, okay, fine. I'd say that we got down. And then after talking a little bit, he realized exactly what we were doing. He says, "The only reason why we're concerned is because we do get a lot of people who lose at the casino and they come and jump off the bridge or try to jump off the bridge." So he says, "I just didn't know what was going on." So after that, he gave me his card. He says, "If you ever want to shoot here again, give us a call first. Let us know you're here." So it's okay, at least we didn't get arrested. Nothing bad happened, but it was still an interesting experience. And we got the shot. And now we go to Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. I used to have to go for work. I used to have to go to Northern New Jersey somewhat often. So instead of kind of sitting around the hotel bar or whatever at night, I would go out and shoot. I'd bring my camera gear. I'd bring flash gear with me. And I'd go out and shoot. And Bethlehem was only about an hour from my hotel. So it was someplace that I would frequent. So one evening after I had dinner, I took a ride out to Bethlehem. And as it's getting dark, and this was June of 2009. So the weather was nice. It was a nice and warm night. So I parked down at the bottom of the bridge and I start walking up. As I'm walking up, I see NS is sitting there. And then I see off in the distance, the Lehigh Valley Rail Management, the two switchers were bringing a cut of double stacks up. So I kind of sprinted up to the bridge, set up. Just as I got everything set up, got the camera turned on, got the cable release in and everything, the conductor was cutting the power away. So I timed this one perfectly. This one was complete and utter pure luck that I got up there in time and was able to get the exposure of the conductor signaling and walking to the other end of the locomotive for the engineer to pull the power away. So I just thought it was kind of a neat, you can see him signaling at the front to stop and then walk down and then give him the signal to pull away. Kind of made the ride well worth it. And here we have a Department of Defense extra. These are nuclear reactors for Virginia class submarines. And they come in probably about twice a year or so. So this particular one, this one was in September of 2010. At that time, the US Coast Guard's Bark Eagle was moored across the river at Fort Trumbull. And I thought this was a pretty cool shot. This one was facilitated because I work at Pfizer, which is located just to the left. So I was able to park my car in the employee parking lot right there, walk over. Security came by and checked on me. I showed my Pfizer badge and they said, okay, do whatever you want to do. And I ended up just hanging out, waiting for them to come through because the tracks actually come through the Pfizer campus in Groton. So as they're bringing the part into Electric Boat, which is just around the curve to the right, kind of got this really neat view with the ship in the background. Oh, in October of 2010, this was, an empty ethanol going northbound on the New England Central. This is in Merrill, Connecticut. And so this was actually the fastest I ever set up a night shot. So I had shot the train in Willimantic when the New England Central picked up the empty ethanol cars from Providence of Worcester. So I raced up and they were moving along fairly well. So I tried to get there well ahead of them to be able to set up a couple of lights. Well, as soon as I turned down this road, I turned on the road. I said, okay, that crossing's not activated. Great, I got a little time. Just as soon as I'm thinking that, the lights start up. I'm like, oh no, I've only got about 30 seconds before he's here. So I raced down, I parked the car in the road, put my hazard lights on, grab one flash out, set it up in front of the car, take a guess on position and setting, get over onto the other side, take a guess. And just as I get over to the stone wall here on the left where I'm standing now, he starts blowing for the crossing. So he's right there. And I just had one shot to get it. And this was it. It was less than 30 seconds that I was able to set the shot up. I try to have a little more time for those. And speaking of night shots, so this is kind of what I would normally do, kind of flat lighting. This is on the Valley Railroad. This is a North Pole Express. This is in Centerbrook, Connecticut. So this was with a couple of flashes, kind of ho-hum. Okay, it wasn't too bad. So I printed this one out and showed it to my wife. And she says, it's okay. Doesn't look like night. It's I'm like, okay. So at that point I started thinking, and at the time I was looking at a lot of Pete Laro's work. If you're familiar with his work, he does a lot of backlighting, cross-lighting, very theatrical, very cinematic, very dramatic lighting. So I started thinking about my setups. It's like, okay, how can I make mine a little bit better? And so I kind of rearranged things and thought about it a little more and went out about 2 weeks later. This particular shot was in late November of 2010. So on December 10th, I kind of call this my epiphany evening. I move the flashes around to create shadows, to create depth. So in this one, there are two lights off to the right of the frame, kind of coming across 97's nose. And there's one flash directly behind the locomotive pointed back at the camera. So that one has given me a little definition underneath the locomotive where you can see the track. And it's also lighting the plume under, from underneath, giving some shadow and light, some nice contrast to it, making, in my opinion, a lot more dramatic photo, something more visually pleasing and not as flat looking. It's got some depth to it. So I have been continuing to refine my process over the years, and I'm not beyond using my kids in my photos either. So I have two daughters, and one evening later that year, on December 28th, 2010, I wanted to get a shot of them waving to the train going by. So in order to do this shot, though, they were very reluctant to do it. The only condition that they would do it is if they could do a silly picture too. So of course I obliged them. So we've got the serious one done first, 97 going north. But then as then the normal operation is they would shove back south down to Deep River and then run around the train there. So on the shove back south, we did the silly picture. The girls just making faces and jumping around and sticking their tongues out. So they were happy with that. And then kind of back to the business trips a little bit. So like I said, I would normally kind of keep it close to where I would stay in the hotel. I usually stayed in like the Manville Bound Brook area, somewhere around there. Our office is in PPAC, so it wasn't too far from there. It was also closer to the railroads. A couple evenings I kind of ventured out when I would end when I would end early at the office, I said, well, let's try and go a little further. So I ended up going out to Fleetwood. This is about the furthest that I would go from the hotel. I think this was about a 2-hour drive from the hotel. Getting that late at night, it was little rough, but on those trips, again, I mean, so like I said, this is just kind of the intro to the next part. So on a March 2011 trip, so this is kind of nondescript in Manville. This is right around dawn. So this is before I would head to the office, went out, took a few pictures, then I'd go work. So I did that morning. So I go, this was a Friday. So I'd already checked out of the hotel. I was ready to go home. So then halfway through the day at the office, I get a call from Bob LeMay. He says, can you get up to Albany this afternoon or this evening, early this evening? So I'm like, yeah, probably. Why? He says, well, there's something special up here. I said, oh, okay. So we end up finishing a little bit early. So I kind of changed my route home. Ended up going right up the thruway up into Albany. Might have bent a speed limit or two, but I did get there in time because that day, Amtrak 156 was at Amtrak's Rensselaer shops. And Bob is good friends, or was good friends, with the folks that run the shop. And basically we had free run of the place that day. So we were able to position the train pretty much anywhere within the yard. We did a bunch of shots all over the place, inside, outside. We were up in the cab, all over the place. And this is when it was fresh out of Beech Grove. It was so new, you could pretty much smell the paint on it. And then kind of the reason for going up there later in the afternoon wasn't something like this, but instead I had my Luminine with me and we did a little night shoot with it. So we had the crew position it here, inside of a nice curve outside the shop. We did a bunch of different shots that evening. Just another one of my trips with Bob LeMay. So this is Providence Worcester ethanol extra going into Willimantic. These are ethanol empties coming back. So the conductor got the funny idea to come out, and I'm assuming he's trying to, quote unquote, ruin my photo. I thought it was hilarious. I thought it looked like Titanic. So I took the shot anyways. I think it was pretty cool. Just something a little bit different. Apparently he's having fun. That's fun. Whatever. Whatever his motivation. So back to Essex. So I had set up this shot. This is at Pratt Cove in Deep River. So I set up this shot. I was kind of happy with it at the end of the night. I wasn't completely satisfied. But the one thing that kind of caught my eye was down in the bottom right corner was the reflection. I had never planned on that. When I set this up, I was just doing a shot of the train going by, trying a little different lighting. There was a couple flashes behind the train and then one off to the right. So that reflection's got me thinking. It's like, okay, well, how can I make that better? And then I looked at the tide charts. Oh, it's low tide, or it was pretty much low tide at this point. So looking at the tide charts, right around, it was about a week later, high tide would be when one of the trains went by. So I said, okay, so I set up that evening. Now, thankfully that evening, there was no wind. There was no nothing, but the air was so still. It was a chilly evening, but it wasn't so cold that there was ice on the water. And that's where I ended up with this one. And this, I am my own worst critic. I typically do not like, I find fault in just about everything I shoot. This is one of the few photos that I am pretty much happy with. This came out almost exactly as how I envisioned it. I really like the reflection, the symmetry of it, the lighting, and this one all came together. But again, I mean, the weather cooperated. It was perfect. It was a nice and still night. There was no wind, no fog, no nothing else to spoil it, if you want to say. And then in 2013, so again, back to my kids, using my kids in a shot. This is Providence Worcester NR2. We are in Ledyard, Connecticut here, along the Thames River. So the Thames River is off to the left. So if you notice, to the left of my daughter's is a guy in a sweatshirt with a fishing pole. So we got down to this spot before sunset. The train is normally through here about 9 o'clock or so, between 9 and 10 o'clock. And so we got there before sunset to set up in the light. The girls were helping me set everything up. We were setting the lights up. So we get all set up. We do a few test shots. Everything's looking good. While we're waiting for the train, and I heard it on the scanner. It was up in Norwich, so it was about 15 minutes away. This guy comes walking down with a fishing pole. So I'm like, okay, so he's going fishing, but in the dark, whatever. Okay, that's a prerogative. So I go over to him. I say, hey, how you doing? Introduce myself. We're set up for a photograph here. There's going to be a freight train coming by within about another 10 minutes. I said, I'm doing a photograph here. I said, I just wanted you to know. So if you wanted to move, he goes, no, it's all right. I'll just stay right here. So I'm like, I said, and I explained to him again. It's like, you're going to be in the photo. He says, okay, that's fine. I don't care. So, okay. So we kind of revised the position of where the girls were going to stand, because they were going to stand a little to the left. So I said, okay, let's move you guys a little over here. So I ended up working him into the scene. It's okay. Life gives you lemons, you make lemonade. And then the kind of the cool thing was that I did give the train warning flash beforehand. So the engineer's looking down at the girls as he's going by. And so this one was August 21st of 2013. So this is a doubleheader on the Valley Railroad. This is in Chester. This one I almost didn't make. This day I was giving a friend of mine from Arkansas a little guided tour of Eastern Connecticut railroads. So we were actually up in Willimantic earlier this day. And at that time, I got a text from Lee Carlson down on the Valley Railroad. Says 40 is going to be tacked on to 3025 to do some tests. The 40 was in the shop for some repairs. So they wanted to do some actual pulling, but they kept 3025 on just in case something happened with 40. So then at least they could still continue to run, because the train here is a revenue run. It's the regular coach train. So Lee texts me, says, hey, there's a doubleheader. 40's going to be on the point, doing some testing with 30, 25 behind it. So I turned to Charlie, who was with me, Charlie Dischinger, if you're familiar with the name. So I said, you want to go down and see a doublehead steam? And he says, absolutely. So we mount up, we get there, and we made it in record time from Willimantic to Chester, just in time to catch this here. Again, a speed limit or two might have been bent almost to a breaking point. But we did make it down here. We caught it in time. We shot it here, and then we ended up going back down to Essex and shoot it there for a couple times. Then they took 40 off and brought it back into the shop, and the 30-25 continued on the last run of the day. And then, so this one, so this is in Deep River, Connecticut. This is one of the Valley Railroad's North Pole setups. They've kind of revised it over the years. This was from 2013. I kind of get bored shooting the same thing over and over again. So instead of moving the lights around, I left the lights where they were here, because I had taken a few shots down close, down at ground level. And they were okay. They weren't bad. But I wasn't satisfied with them. So I kind of thought about it a little bit. And then I decided to do the stupid thing. And because there's snow and ice on the ground, I climbed up on top of the rock cut, which the tracks go through. It's called Tate's Cut. It was a little icy. It wasn't too bad. It wasn't too perilous, but we'll get into something like that later. But instead of firing when I would kind of normally would, when the locomotive was in the light and then leaving the dark, I mean, kind of minimizing the dark around, zoom in a little more. Instead, I went the opposite direction, zoomed out a bit, left a lot of darkness around it, and let the locomotive come into the dark, into the shadow, and only basically highlight the trees, the village, and the plume. And then letting the headlight put a little bit of glint onto the rails just to kind of highlight them a little bit there. This one I kind of call Embraced by Darkness, just because the whole North Pole scene is surrounded by just darkness. There's another one that I'm mostly satisfied with. And here's something you don't see every day, Amtrak in Essex. The Amtrak exhibit train was brought into Essex Station as one of the stops when it was touring the country. And this was in 2014, the summer of 2014. So while the exhibit train was there, Amtrak police was on site and was not allowing people to be on the property. The Valley Railroad was very strict about that. I had worked out with them, with both the Valley and and then they cleared it with Amtrak as well, that we had a small group of photographers. I think we had about a half a dozen people do a quick night shoot with the Amtrak equipment there, because we figured it was unique. It was something that probably would never happen again. So we spent about an hour or two just going around, and the Amtrak police officer that was on duty there thought it was pretty cool. And he was watching the stuff that we were shooting. He says, that's pretty cool what you guys are doing. But it was a unique opportunity, something that, like I said, probably never see again. Another one from the Valley. So the genesis of this one, this photo, we specifically set up for one of the Friends of the Valley Railroad calendars. They try and do a theme every year. This particular year, so this one was shot, this was in October of 2014. So I think this was going to be in the 2016 calendar. I think that's what it ended up being. And the theme for that one was steel wheels and rubber tires. So it was going to be photographs featuring the Valley's trains and cars together. So one of the guys in the Friends of the Valley Railroad, Paul Costello, was able to get a Bentley. And then that's his wife, that's Paul's wife, Michelle, in the stairwell there. And what we did for the train, and this is actually the dinner train. So what they did is the dinner train came back, all their passengers got off, then they pulled the dinner train back up onto the station platform where we had the Bentley and the lights set up. We had a smoke generator down below the platform at track level, just to kind of give it a little more like steam heat kind of a look. And Brent on the left there was the actual conductor on the dinner train that evening. So we took maybe a half hour of their time, did a bunch of shots around there, and then they were off on their way to put the train away and go off duty. And this is Providence Worcester NR2. This is at Shaw's Cove on the Amtrak shoreline. Story with this one is I rode along with NR2. Some years back, I'd rode with NR2 when it was a day job, and it switched to night, so that I arranged with the PNW management at the time to ride along with NR2 to kind of do a contrast. I was thinking about possibly doing an article at some point, kind of contrasting the day job versus the night job. So that evening, this was September of 2015. So I get to Plainfield, which is where the job originates, check in with the crew. So we're all talking and they told me, I said, well, sorry, tonight's going to be a quick night. They had to stop at Rings End and Nyanic. Then they had to go just to Pine Orchard Madison, I think. And then back and then Groton real quick for a quick switch and then back home. So they said, well, we'll probably be, they were on duty at 8 o'clock. They said, we'll probably be home midnight, 1 a.m., somewhere around there. So it would be a quick turn. I said, yeah, that's fine. No problem at all. Well, Amtrak had other plans for us. So after we got onto the shoreline, worked at Rings End, went out to Pine Orchard, came back from Pine Orchard heading to Groton, we're coming across the Connecticut River drawbridge, and Amtrak says, I'm going to have to hold you guys at Shaw's. And I said, okay, why? Apparently, Amtrak Maintenance of Way took both mains out of service at the crossings in New London because they were replacing the crossings. So they had us sit there. It ended up being, I think we were there for about 3 hours, just sitting there waiting. So out of boredom, I had one flash with me. So I look at the conductor. I said, do you mind if I get down and do a shot? He said, no, I'll come with you. So we both went down. He says, nothing's coming. It's all shut down. Nothing's going to be moving. So I actually did a quick night shot right on the corridor. So after we got a few shots there, got back up in the cab, essentially took a nap. And then finally we ended up going through, switching out Tilcon and Groton. By the time we finished there, it was almost 5 a.m. And at that point, I was getting a little bleary-eyed because I worked my day job all day and then was up the entire time. So I got these crazy ideas in my head, and I ended up clamping my camera to the handrail on one of the locomotives as we were going up the east leg of the Groton Y under the Gold Star Bridge. And I got this shot. Not the greatest technically, it's a little fuzzy, little blurry, little motion blur on the locomotive, but it does impart that sense of motion under the bridge. Again, I mean, just kind of came out of being exhausted and said, oh, let's try this. It may not work, it may work, who knows? But it ended up, came out pretty cool, and it looks really good printed. This is another one that I'm mostly happy with. A couple things I would have done differently, but I like the way it came out. I like the feel of it. And this one, water. So again, back on the Valley Railroad. So I was riding along with the engine crew on this day, and this was July 30th of 2016. So this was the first run of the day. So they had gone and filled up the coal bunker with coal, and their standard practice is to wet it down so it controls the dust. So basically they're not covering the passengers with dust, because the first car is their open air car where there's no windows in it. It's a pretty cool experience. And you do get some cinders, but they just want to minimize the dust flying in there. So I wanted to get a shot of the fireman, and that's, I believe it's Bill Fredrickson. wetting down the coal. So he grabs the hose and I'm standing in the cab pointed back. And just as he opens the valve, I fire off a burst of shots and I get drenched. Yes, I got drenched. Yes, the camera got drenched, but it was worth it. I got the shot and the camera was fine. It's been through much worse than that. Okay, now we go up to the Preston Ledyard town line along the Thames River. So the town line goes right down the middle, left to right on the bridge there. The left side of the frame is the Thames River. The right side of the frame is Pequetanuck Cove. This is NR2 when it was a day job. This one was taken in April of 2012. So this spot here is about a 10-minute hike from the parking area at Stoddard Cove, which is just to the south of here. And then not only a 10-mile hike in, this location, it's on essentially a rock cut almost. And I'm about 12 feet off the ground. So you got to climb up. It's fairly steep. But I do like the shot because you can get up above the train. You can see the roof line going down, nice curve there. So this is one of my favorite locations to go and shoot along the Thames. So in October of 2017, the Mass Bay Railroad enthusiasts chartered a train. I think they called it the Two Rivers Steam Special. So it started in Worcester, went down to Groton, then went over to Old Saybrook, where the PNW handed the train off to the Valley Railroad. And then Valley Railroad 3025 would take the train north to the end of the operable track up in Haddam, and then come back south, hand it back off to the PNW, and then they would head back to Worcester. So I caught them here in Thompson. I caught them at one other spot as they were crossing over Interstate 395. Then I figured I'd get ahead of them and go back to my spot there along Thames River, Pequetanuck Cove. So I get there and I make my hike, I park, hike down there, and I get to my spot, start climbing up the side of the rock face. I get about three quarters of the way up and I feel my boot starting to slip out from under me. I'm like, well, that's not good. So here I am with two cameras, three lenses, feeling myself starting to fall. So I reach out, I see a branch in front of me. So I reach out, grab the branch, or try to grab the branch. As I'm reaching out, the branch is getting further away from me. I'm falling down the rocks. I end up falling probably about 8 feet at this point, right onto the ballast and the rocks below. It was a hard hit. I didn't break anything, thankfully. I didn't break the cameras either. And that was actually after I dusted myself off and I told my wife about it. And she said, her first question was, did you break the camera? And I said, no, those are fine. But I was banged up pretty bad. So I started walking around. I didn't want it to stiffen up. It hurt like crazy. So needless to say, I didn't get up to my perch to take the shot, but it did get a little lower angle. I wasn't, like I said, nothing was broken. I wasn't bleeding profusely. I was bleeding a little bit. I ripped my pants, the leg of my pants, and I could feel my leg was getting swollen, but I didn't feel it was an emergency that I had to leave to hike all the way back out. So I was just kind of pacing back and forth to stay loose so it didn't stiffen up. I got the shot of the train coming down. So instead of going to the other spots that I had planned along the way, I said, well, I'm going to go to CVS, buy some bandages, buy some something to clean it up. I ended up and check myself out, basically, see what it is. But I ended up with some pretty bad abrasions, but I cleaned myself up in the CVS bathroom, bandaged myself up, and then drove out to Deep River, where I made about a 600-foot hike, 200 yards or so, from a parking area out into the woods along the trail. So I got the train being pulled up by 3025 among some nice foliage. But at that point, my leg was killing me. And I was looking at it, was getting more and more swollen. So it's like, okay, I guess I'm done for the day. So I shot him there, and I shot him going away over Rattling Valley Road. And then at that point, I said, you know what? I can't take it anymore. It was killing. So I drove myself to the emergency room. Actually, the first emergency room that I, the emergency clinic that I went to, at that point, my insurance company wasn't working with Hartford Healthcare or something, so they couldn't take me. So I had to drive another, about a half an hour away to another one that I knew that would take me. So anyways, either way, I ended up with some bad, a really bad hematoma, bad swelling, some really bad abrasions, cuts. I still have the scars, but I got the shots. I didn't get all the shots I had wanted, but I got something. And I got the scars to prove it. And this one is a Shoreline East at Shaw's Cove in London. No real story behind this one. I just wanted to throw a pretty picture in there. That's about it. Well, the only story is those are no longer painted in the New Haven colors. They're now wearing the new CT Rail, affectionately called Coke Zeros. Okay, so in 2018, the Valley Railroad was completing the boiler rebuild on 97. And I had been photographing the process along the way. For this shot, you're looking down into the steam dome. On the left is the dry pipe, which goes up to the superheaters. On the right is the rod for the throttle, which goes into the cab for the throttle control. And then down below it are the fire tubes. And then you can see one of the superheater tubes, the larger one down at the bottom of the frame. For those of you that know me, I was a larger guy. I'm 6'2". At this time that I took this photo, I was probably about 250 pounds. So I wasn't a small guy. I decided that I was going to wriggle myself down into the boiler to get a shot. So I squeezed myself down there with my camera, get down there, lay down on top of the tubes to get this view. So what we're looking over the firebox. So that'll be the firebox on the bottom. That's the crown sheet. And then all of the stay bolts across the top are out. They were being replaced. They were being manufactured in the shop and then replaced. And so it was a part of the rebuild project. So I just figured it was a unique view, something that, again, you really don't get all that often. So I squeezed myself down in there. It was kind of difficult to get in and out of there, but I got in and out. I did take subsequent shots after that. After this, I didn't wriggle myself down in there. I put my camera on the monopod again and stuck it down in there. I did it the easy way, but this one I got down there for real. So a little later into the project, this is the CMO, Wayne Hebert. He's peening over the stay bolts. Basically, what it does is it's an air hammer that basically mushrooms the top of the stay bolt, sealing it into the outer sheet. So it's hard work. It's a pain in the butt. This particular day, this was August 28th, 2018, and it was probably about 98 degrees outside. Felt like it was about 200 in the shop. So we were all sweating bullets. But so after Wayne finishes this bolt, he looks at me, he says, "Give Ron your camera and get a pair of gloves." I'm like, "Why?" So I give Ron my camera, put on a pair of gloves, and he hands me the hammer. He says, "Go ahead." So I got to do one of the stay bolts on 97's back head. Not the greatest job in the world, but I can say that I worked on it. Just a little different perspective, a little more respect for these guys and what they do. But at the end of that project, they debuted 97 on a Mass Bay Railroad enthusiast trip. It was a doubleheader trip with 97 and 3025. 40 was, as seen on the right, on the hand on the throttle that day. That's a program where the Valley Railroad basically you pay like $500 and you get to operate the locomotive for an hour. It's a pretty cool thing. I have yet to do it. I'll probably do it one day. But so 40 was doing it there, and kind of the secret this day was for the last run by, they were actually going to take 40 and put it into the contest, and it was going to be triple header. Unfortunately, 97 on the way north had bearing issues, so they had to cut that off and basically limp back to Essex. But we got through most of the run bys with 97 and 3025. For the last one, they ended up tacking 40 onto 3025. Still had a doubleheader, but it wasn't the secretly planned tripleheader. So I was riding along on the train, photographing and everything. So as we're departing Essex, apparently Warren there wasn't very happy with me. He's saying I'm number one. He was a little jealous that I was riding and he wasn't. But so this day we ended up going, bringing steam as far north as possible. So this was the end of the operable track at that point. This is good speed yard limits. I think it's about a mile north of good speed yard. The track has been extended a little bit further beyond this point, but at this was the furthest north that steam had operated probably in at least 80, 100 years. I'm not sure exactly when the last steam ran on the Valley Line. But it's the furthest north that steam has operated since the Valley Railroad has been operating it. And that's been 50 years now. So of course I had to get off the train to memorialize the event of them at good speed yard limits. One of the traditions that I do with the Valley Railroad, and I have been doing it probably for about the past 6 or 7 years now, is a crew portrait on the last day of North Pole Express season. So we usually gather the locomotives together, gather the crews together, everybody poses, we do a quick picture. So this was the 2018 one. Unfortunately, we couldn't get 97 in there. 97 was operating during the season, but they ended up putting it in the shop early because bearing issues were cropping up again. So we could only do the two locomotives, just 3025 and 40. So this was the 2018 one. So in 2019, we wanted to make it a point that we got all three together for the crew portrait. So at the end of the season, we ended up doing that. We got all three together, positioned them, got all the crews together, did a nice shot with the three locomotives together and the three crews. Then after we got this, 97 pulled up a little bit, because eventually she would end up going into the shop for the night. So 97 sitting there, and at this point, the three noses were together. And then I hear Bruce Edgerton, which is one of the engineers, yell over to me and say, "Hey, Tom, come over here, take a look at this. I think you'd like this angle a little better." So I said, "All right." So I go over there. I'm like, "Whoa, that's pretty cool." So I climbed up on one of the diesels that was sitting over there, and I got this nice lineup of the three locomotives. But then I kind of thought a little further, and it's like, well, you know what? I think down lower would be pretty cool. So I ended up getting down off of the diesel and ended up getting this shot. And this one I am very happy with. This one came out very well. Shows three hot steam locomotives just at the end of the night, just simmering away. This was a pretty cool evening. And the railroad thought so also, because they ended up buying it from me and making it into a banner that they ended up using at Springfield. So this is the Springfield train show. And that is the largest any photo of mine has ever been printed. I forgot the dimensions on it, but it's got to be 8 foot tall by probably 12 foot long, something like that. But it was still pretty cool seeing one of my photos that printed that large. And that was January of 2020. Then, of course, COVID hit. And everything kind of came to a screeching halt, including my rail photography. As I said earlier, I work for Pfizer, so we were a little intense in 2020. Basically, everything was in. If a problem comes up that could potentially affect the vaccine, it was drop everything and do it. So I really didn't. I wasn't able to get out of the house much, really away from home much, other than going grocery shopping or something like that. And not much was running either. I mean, even the freight around here, I couldn't find the time and with work going on. So kind of think everything took about a 6-month pause. And then in June, late June, the Valley started limited operations back up again. So I went out the first weekend that they started running some excursion trains. It was limited. It was just the train ride. They weren't doing the riverboat at that point. So I got a shot of 40 coming north on the Essex Deep River Town line. And because of the mood was starting to look up and up a little more, the firemen back in Essex, when the train was back in Essex, decided to brighten things up a little bit, put some lilies into the knuckle of 40. Kind of a unique vase, but just to give a little color and a little lightness to the mood. Okay, and here's this was July of 2007. The engineer is Jim Altieri, and I was riding along with 40. This was soon after 40 came out from a major rebuild. So I figured let's get some shots of the essentially new locomotive. So I was riding with Jim, and Ken Blandina was the fireman that day. So it was a great day. I ended up getting this shot. This was a pretty cool shot. And then fast forward to late 2020, I get an email from one of the Valley Railroad folks saying, do you mind if we use that picture of Jim for a poster? So yeah, sure. I says, well, they're planning. I said, why, what's going on? He said, they were planning a farewell for Jim. He was retiring, but they ended up doing a special trip because they were not running many steam trips. At this point, this was later in the season. This was in November. So they did on November 13th, they arranged a special charter, essentially a charter for Jim to be able to operate. And it was invitation only. It was Valley Railroad employees and Jim's family that rode the train. So they gave Jim an opportunity to operate the train one last time before his full retirement. He ended up retiring at the end of the year. And they wanted to make sure that he was able to get something because there was nothing going on because of COVID. So I was asked to photograph the trip, to basically spend the day in the cab with Jim and the crew. So the entire time I ended up shooting God knows how many frames the whole time, did a full documentation of his trip, gave Jim and his family copies of all the photos for their keeping. But one of them kind of stuck out to me as my favorite of the group. And it's this one of Jim coming back south. So we're pulling back south. I think we're in Deep River here. It's just looking right into the camera with that smile on his face. You know he's enjoying it. He's just having a blast. It was a rainy day, but it was the best day of his life, it seemed. He was really enjoying running one last time. Okay, and then here we are back to Deep River, and this was actually a few days ago, late last week. This is September 2nd. So this is actually, if you notice, it's September, but it's all dressed up for Christmas. And the other thing, if you notice, normally the station sign would be Deep River. Here it says Shepherd's Ferry. What had happened is the Hallmark Channel was in town filming a Christmas movie. And I got to document the behind the scenes. I can't get into too many details about the movie itself, but it was a pretty cool experience to watch and to be able to photograph. but it was it was pretty cool. I mean, we started at dusk and went through the evening, but it was kind of surreal being in shorts in September. It's 75, 80 degrees out, and they got it all dressed up for Christmas. They have fake snow down on the ground. But it was pretty cool. And the actors are all dressed up in winter clothes and hats and everything. But it was pretty cool experience. So here's a couple of frames. There's that one. And then this one where the film crew is filming one of the takeoffs from the station. Leaning out of the window is Ron Olson. He was a fireman that night. And then I got a few left here. They're kind of tributes. So late 2020, we lost Lee Carlson. He's a friend of a lot of us. I'm sure a lot of us on here are familiar with, at least with the name of Lee, if not know him well. He passed away, I think it was it late December, early January, somewhere around there of this year. And the Valley Railroad did something in his honor. They put together a charter for his friends and family. And then later in the day, they ended up doing a photo freight for the rail fans. So this is the first charter, which brought his friends and family up from Essex. And then he also had family meet us at Chester, where they dedicated a bench outside of Chester Station, which was one of Lee's favorite places to watch the train go by. So now there's a bench there in his memory at Chester Station. I thought it was a great gesture, and my kind of contribution to it, other than the photography, was I also printed this picture of Lee that I took of him inside the Chester Station of one of the North Pole Expresses going by. I printed that and framed it, and it is inside the Chester Station now. I also gave Lee's husband a copy as well as a copy of all the photos in his memory. Just kind of memorials the friend that he was. And then to close things out, and I had to include a picture of Andy Dick. I took this one in June of 2012. Over on the left, there's Andy with his father. I think they were about to board and ride the train. And if I remember correctly, I think not long after this, Andy's father passed away. But I wanted to include one of Andy to recognize him as well, that we all miss him and wish his family the best. And that concludes my show. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Tom.
Yeah, thank you, Tom, and a nice tribute to Andy too.
Thank you.
Very nice, and your use of lights and darks is outstanding.
Thank you very much.
That especially that shot of the former Conrail unit going by the old building there, that one you took 30 seconds to set up.
Yep.
You know,
yep.
Sometimes it works that way. You could be there 2 hours and not do any better than that.
Yeah.
You
know? Yep. Exactly. Yep. Yep. Thank you.
We do have some questions that came in, if you don't mind, Tom.
Yeah, not at all.
Two different people asked, what lighting equipment do you typically use for your night photography?
Okay, I use studio flashes. I have a set of Alien Bees, which are higher output AC flashes. And I've also, I also use Profoto, which is kind of a higher end, but they're all battery operated. I'm kind of starting to fold those into my work. But all the stuff that you saw here was lit mainly with ANBs. I do also have a couple of Lumadynes, which are small battery powered flashes, but it is all high powered stuff. I don't do the smaller shoe mount flash really for this kind of stuff. I prefer to have more output and less of them. It's less setup time, it's less to manage, less to blow over, basically. That's about it.
right, cool. And we have a question about the Valley Railroad. Do you know how much further north the Valley will be running this year?
Well, the dinner train usually goes all the way to the pretty much the end of the track that it is right now. Because, well, right now they can't go further north because there's actually one of the abutting property owners many years ago had filled in over the tracks for their driveway. And I think it's about a, I think probably about 10, 12 feet high that their driveway goes over. So they end up, they do have a plan to clear that and put a bridge in its place, but that's as far north as that'll go. They do sometimes run specials, steam powered specials up to Goodspeed Station in Haddam. They just ran a couple up there. They had some concert extras where they were shuttling people. People could ride the train from Essex or pick it up anywhere along the line and ride up to Haddam where they had a bus go over to, because they had free concerts over by Goodspeed Opera House across the river. So they would shuttle them over on bus and come back and ride the train back to wherever they came. I think they did like two or three of those this year. As far as actual plans, I'm not sure what they have. I don't think there's much of anything steam powered going that far north. Like I said, I know the dinner train goes that far north, and North Pole Express does not go that. They go as far north as North Chester, and that's still the same plan as far as I know this year.
Right, cool. Had a couple questions come in. Or is there anywhere that people can purchase copies of your photographs?
Yeah, I do have some up on my website, nanosphoto.com. You can contact me directly if there are particular ones you're interested in. You can drop me an email, tom@nanosphoto.com. Just drop me a note, or and I can either add it to the site there, or I can print something off myself here if it's small enough. But definitely, I do have a bunch of stuff up there. I don't regularly add new stuff, but I can add whatever you're interested in to that collection up there.
All right, great. That's the end of the questions. Okay. Definitely lots of positive comments, Tom. Lots of compliments coming in throughout the show. So
thank you.
Great presentation, Tom. We're happy to have you.
Excellent. Yes. Thank you very much.
Yep, fantastic.
I'm glad that I could do it. Good.
All right, cool. So thank you everyone for tuning in. Tom, thanks again. Everyone who's still with us, our next show will be October 14th, Conrail Research and Business Trains. So we're looking forward to that, and we'll see you again next time.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Good night, everybody.
Everybody.